Hey guys, it's Ted Bogert with the Ted Show. We're here for No Jacket Monday. Thank you, Ralph. We are going to have a great time. I'm so excited to have Ralph Andracchio on the show today.
Thank you. Very excited
to have him on here. I love this topic, going from or go from I can't to I can, and telling your story in a different way is kind of the subtitle or something like that. But he came highly recommended. I looked him up, which you guys know, I don't spend a ton of time doing that. And I am just excited for his presentation, his words of wisdom. So with that, welcome, Ralph.
Thank you so much for having me. I'm happy to be here.
I'm excited. All right. So origin story. It's important for me and it's important for the audience. We love to kind of know your journey because I think a lot of people watch these and they think, oh, Ted and Ralph have it all together. Their journeys must have been wonderful and it's all been unicorns and rainbows. And that's not always the case. So tell us a little bit about you and how we got to information coaching.
Well, I was bitten by a radioactive spider and gained all my powers that way. I actually started coming into my own about 12-ish years ago or so in 2008. My partner and I had just moved back to town from LA. We lived there for a few years, had some friends in the business. I had a friend who did comedy and I found improv and bought myself a class as a birthday present for myself in 2008 and never looked back. Took my first class and I was like, oh my God, this is amazing. It's everything I'm looking for. Cause it kind of helped me discover like myself, kind of get reintroduced to myself, the power that I have, my voice, my opinions. And
there's a vulnerability in improv that I think people don't give credit for.
Absolutely. And over the years, I learned more about it, learned more about myself, learned how to be a better listener, better speaker, a better friend, a better partner, better community member. It just helps you on so many levels. And then after doing it for a while, I got to teach. So I'm an instructor and I've taught hundreds of students all over the United States. I've performed at festivals and all that good stuff and run workshops and corporate trainings. And I love sharing the power of improv with everybody. And I eventually quit my full-time job. I had a full-time job for 10 years. I worked at a nonprofit based in DC and came to a fork in the road of, do I keep the job with a steady paycheck and the 401k and, you know, not have to worry about that? Or do I jump in feet first into what I'm really passionate about and I love and really dig into touching people's lives and helping them? And I decided to do that and research.
What was the one, people always get to that point. We talk about it on the show a lot. You get to that point where you're at that fork. What was it that gave you the strength or the courage to actually take the leap at that moment?
That's a good question. I sat down and I thought about it because I was working basically two full-time jobs and I actually pushed myself to the point where I had to make a decision because I had no energy left. So I sat down and I thought to myself, you know, one of these has to go. And I thought, what's more important to me? Is my mental health, my emotional health, my happiness more important, or is a steady paycheck more important, you know, no matter what? And talk to my friends, talk to my partner. And then I realized, you know, I need to put focus on my happiness because if I'm happier as a person with myself, my emotional happiness, my mental happiness, my spiritual happiness, that kind of ripples out and affects everybody else I know. And that was more important to me. And I know that I'm a resourceful person. And if I put my mind to it and did my research and got educated, I could make a living out of this. And that's what happened. I found coaching and took classes. I'm currently still taking classes. I think I'm always going to take classes. I like to be a student. You know, I like to learn every day. So, and opened my own business last January. And
congratulations.
Thank you. Yes.
I think it's so amazing when people do take the leap because most people that actually every person I've talked to that has taken a leap, even if they have taken a second leap, they always say, I know I wasn't ready, but gosh, I wish I was ready prior to taking the leap. I wish I would have had the strength or the whatever it was that made me take the leap a little earlier. Mm-hmm. I think people really don't look back. You're looking forward at that point because you finally, probably for the first time in your life, made a decision that wasn't in the norm as everybody describes. The job with the 401k and the health insurance and you know, the white picket fence and all that good stuff that people dream of or that they tell you you should dream of. And so for you to take that leap is so big. I mean, kudos to you. I think it's really important for more people to get out there and live their passion. What was it, though, improv wise? It's one thing to be an improv student and learn and then come back and do more of it and teach, but then to actually convert that to something that can help business owners, not just improv comedians and comedians. What was that like? What was the process of that?
It was actually, for me, it was pretty simple because I like approaching improv from a very intuitive point of view. And for me, it was, I just looked at all these tools that are available in improv and I was teaching people how to be better listeners, how to get in touch with what you really want to say, how you really want to say it, being comfortable in your own skin, believing in yourself, believing that what you're saying and your point of view matters, and working better in a team, you know, being a better conversationalist. All these things are applicable everywhere. Like in my classes, I've had doctors, I've had lawyers, I've had psychiatrists, I've had teachers, and they all share the same thing. They want to get to know themselves better. They want to be able to communicate better. They want to be able to work in a team better, make better decisions. And that's really on a really weird general level is what I was teaching people in these classes. It's not about teaching you to be funny. It's about teaching you to listen and be present and lose yourself in this moment and connect with that other person and figure it out together. And that's applicable anywhere. So that was easy for me to take that and make a business out of it because everybody needs to learn more about that. Myself included, you know, all good coaches have coaches, all good teachers have teachers. So it's applicable everywhere and everybody can use it no matter what.
You've mentioned listening a few times, and I'm a big proponent of this. And I think we all believe we listen. And most of the time, it's not accurate at all. I can always tell when somebody is just waiting for me so they can respond instead of hearing anything that I've said. But it can be difficult when you're in the heat of things or when you're really trying to prove your point or when you're passionate about something. But the stepping back and listening and actually being present is so critical. How do you teach someone that?
Oh man, that's the $64 million question. that's the most important thing for me. And I teach workshops just about listening. It's far too often we're kind of conditioned to just wait for our turn to talk instead of actually, like you said, listening to what the other person's saying and really processing it. And I could spend hours with somebody just walking through that. And I think I have it easier in performing and improv because I get to do it in the framework of a scene. And we can repeat that scene over the same conversation over and over and say, okay, try it this way. Now we're gonna do it again, really listen to what they're saying. And they get a chance to go back and kind of have a redo of that, what happened. And I think it teaches you. It's like any other muscle. It's like riding a bike. The more you do it, the easier it gets. And it kind of shifts back into our subconscious where we don't have to think about it as much. But I always challenge people to kind of take a step out when they're talking to somebody. And am I really listening to what they're saying or am I just waiting? Like, am I going through my head? I'm flipping through my Rolodex of like one-liners to say or like zingers or like, oh, I have this great factoid that I'm going to pull on them and they're going to be so impressed. And while you're thinking about all that stuff, you're missing what the other person's saying. And that opportunity, that moment's never going to come back. It's gone forever.
I've been practicing so much that there are times when a guest is talking and I am listening to everything up until their last word and I haven't formed my next thought. And it looks like I'm a complete idiot for about 30 seconds because I'm so intrigued and processing that whole thing. And so occasionally, guys, that's a secret out there. If you see me go, it's because I have listened to everything they've said and I'm trying to figure out how to respond.
That's such a great point. And I want to expand on that for just a minute because we've been conditioned as a society to fill every space with sound. There can be no silence because if there's silence, we feel awkward. And if we feel awkward, then it throws everything off. I also teach the importance of silence because it's a really integral part of conversation. Conversations have those lulls and it's okay if there's a little bit of silence. That's where we process. That's where we think. That's where some interesting new connections happen. So it's okay if somebody talks and there's a pause afterwards. We don't have to immediately jump on that last word that they said and start our own sentence. You can have those pauses. It's okay. I think getting used to and comfortable with those silences is a part of being a better conversationalist. And if you notice, I'm taking pauses as well because I try to get myself to not use filler words like or or as or so. Or
it's a work in progress, right?
Right. I'm okay with taking those pauses and it's okay. You become a more comfortable conversationalist when you do that.
The silence thing I think gets people. I oftentimes people will say to me, "You're so quiet." And if they're good friends or close friends, I can say, "Well, who could get a word in edgewise with you people?" Right. Because I'm really trying to take it all in. And it is, it's like a muscle. I'm learning. This isn't something, I think most people, it's the opposite of what we're trained or conditioned to do. Mm-hmm. And so you really have to work on it. And I had somebody say this weekend, "You're pretty quiet." I go, "Well, I'm really listening to everything you guys are saying, but we get so weirded out by quiet or silence. We don't know, oh God, are they mad? What are they thinking? Do I look stupid? Why are they just sitting there staring at me?" Yeah. We're listening, guys. I mean, we're really listening and trying. All right. I have to ask before it gets too late in the show.
Yes.
I love this topic. Go from I can't to I can.
Yes.
I think a lot of people have an I can't mindset. They have a lack mindset versus an abundance mindset. And it just impacts everything they do. Where did this come from? And then maybe you could give us a couple of pointers on how to make that transition.
Sure, absolutely. So I'm a big fan of positive psychology, and I try to use it in my practice when I can. And I think there's a misconception of positive psychology as always, you know, always looking on the bright side of life, and it's always being happy and all, you know, and it's not really about that. It's more about challenging the notion that there's always something bad, and we have to overcome all this bad stuff in our life. And really what I try to do is look at it from the flip side and say, what if we looked at everything as an opportunity and took a lot of the judgment out of it of like, okay, this happened. Where's the opportunity for growth? What can I learn from this? What can I do better next time? What am I good at? What can I build on? It's instead of looking at the negatives and saying, how can I fix this? It's looking at the positives and saying, how can I build on these and live my best life, make myself better, make everybody around me better. And that's what I try to do. So going from I can't to I can, they're two sides of the same coin. And it's really just looking at it from a different point of view because we all tell ourselves a story every day about who we are, what we can do, what we can accomplish. And it's changing your story and telling yourself a different story and saying, instead of focusing on the things I can't do, focus on the things I can do and say, how can I build on these positives that I already have? So that's what I mean from going from I can't to I can. It's just flipping the script that you're telling yourself.
I think it's so important to do that. I have people that I know that some, and we all probably have people in our lives that you text them or you message them or you reach out and you're just almost wincing because you know no matter how sunny of a day it is, they're having a cloud over them. It's going to start mm-hmm. with the cloud, and everything is the list of the negatives in their life. And mm-hmm. If I'm coaching someone, I'm not an official coach, but I'm helping someone, a friend. I'm always like, so what's the positive? Is there anything? Is there a silver lining in that terrible rain cloud hanging over your head? Yeah. What is that? But people are so conditioned to do that. It's a comfort zone they get in, I think. Mm-hmm. And I feel like that when they begin to step out, it's almost like if they admit that something might be good, they're waiting for the other shoe to drop.
Yeah. And I think as a society, we've been conditioned that always looking on the bright side or trying to find the positives and thing is like a soft way to look at life. Like, oh, you got to toughen yourself up, you know, focus on the negatives and how you can overcome. And it's like this, I pulled myself up by my bootstraps and overcame. Like, yes, I'm not saying to ignore the negatives. We all have bad stuff that happens, but it's putting it in a different context. It's not focusing on them exclusively. It's saying, okay, this something negative happened. I'm going to give myself permission to feel that and have that space for that to affect me. But then, okay, now how do I, what can I learn from this? What are the opportunities? How can I grow from this?
Then I have people on the flip side who are positive about everything, and they do not want to admit they're having a bad day or allow themselves to feel anything because it's a giant sign of weakness. So right. I had a friend who was in the hospital, lost a parent, all this stuff. And I'm like, is there anything I can do? Oh, you know what? I'm strong. I'm going to be fine. No, you're not. I mean, you're going to be fine, yes, but it's okay to say I'm having a rough day, week, whatever it is. I feel like you need to embrace it. You need to go, okay, I'm feeling this. Why? What can I do? But if you mm-hmm. just block it all the time, people are so quick to block that negative feeling that they're allowed to have. Yeah. It's a balance of some kind. I don't know what the answer is, but.
Yeah. It's integrating all that together and finding a place where it all kind of meshes. And you're right. It's not pushing anything aside or ignoring anything. It's taking your life as a whole and experiencing it and living it. That's how we learn. That's how we grow is by, you know, every day stepping a little bit further out of our comfort zones. That's, you know, that's what I tell my students. That's what I tell my clients. I want you to have the biggest playground possible to play and grow in. The only way you do that is to step outside your comfort zone. And when you take that step, your playground grows a little bit and it never goes back. It can never shrink again. It only expands.
Love that. I love that. Is good. That's good. That's right. It never shrinks.
Nope,
so was you going outside of your comfort zone, part of your lasagna championship? Aren't you the lasagna king?
I think it's part of my Italian heritage because I have such fond memories of my whole family in a kitchen, you know, cooking and telling stories and laughing and there's music playing. So that's a big part of my life is food and like being able to cook and like having dinner parties. And it's a way for everybody. It's a very easy way for everybody to connect is through food. So that's another thing I encourage people to do is, you know, have parties where y'all cook for each other and have fun and play music and like enjoy life like that. Get all your senses involved because it's such a great experience, a shared experience with everybody, especially now that we're all so physically separate. I think once we come out of the other side of the quarantine, we're going to be craving all of that. So the more really solid, wonderful, like quality time you can have with each other, the better.
So you obvious, I agree with that, by the way, 100%. I feel like food, I can't cook. Like, I think I can boil water. It would be a challenge, but I could try it. But I feel like we miss out on that whole creation of an experience of food. I grew up in the same kind of, on the Italian side. It was all about the food and the tasting and the prepping and the cleaning and the camaraderie. And mm-hmm. I just have such fond memories. I have smell memories of that and sound memories and just things that I will never forget that were so positive. And I feel like we don't do that as a whole as much as we used to.
Because I think we think it has to be perfect. And there is no such thing as perfect. Get that out of your head. Perfect does not exist. It's the experience of it. Even if you're trying to boil water with your friends and it goes horribly, tragically wrong, it's an experience that you had that you can laugh about. That's what I'm saying right. about looking at the positives. Like, yeah, maybe I burnt everything I was trying to cook for y'all tonight, but it's a fun experience that we had and we can laugh about it. And it's this shared moment that we now have.
I love it. All right. So before we ask you all your information, I always like to ask guests, especially anybody who's on the positivity side, the coaching side, mm-hmm. If you had to pick a person or a single influence in your life that made a huge difference, a giant impact, maybe helped change the trajectory of life, who comes to mind?
Oh gosh, that's a good question. Yikes. I'm gonna say my dad, I think. Because I have fond memories of them, you know, instilling all this into me of like standing up for what you believe in and caring about people and you know, doing what makes you happy and following your dreams and following your passions. So I think if I didn't have that as a kind of foundation, I wouldn't be where I am today. So I'm gonna Do the cop out answer and say my parents.
I think that's such a great answer because when it's the first person that comes to your mind,
yeah,
that's what it should be. So it doesn't negate everybody else who's helped you and made you happy and influenced yeah. you. It just is that one person. And I think that a lot of times when people like you come on and you're working on your journey, you're a great work in progress, people are like, gosh, I wonder who impacted him. And so we like to ask that question. All right. So what is the best way if somebody wants to learn more about you and what you do and maybe how to go from I can't to I can, what's the best way for them to reach you?
Yes, absolutely. You can, the easiest way is to go to my website, informationcoaching.com. You can read about my story. You can read about what I'm doing, my philosophy about coaching. I have my program on there. I also do a live bi-weekly Zoom cast called Friday Formula, which is much like this. I have a guest on every time. We talk about their passion, how they got where they are. And it's a really great spirited conversation. You can find all those on my website. I'm also on Facebook and LinkedIn. You just look for Info Coach Ralph and you can find all that on there. I post daily. And I'm always open to meeting new people and hearing new stories. So please reach out if you read about me and you like what you see. Message me on Facebook or LinkedIn, get in touch, connect, and I would love to set up some time to chat with you.
You're such a joy. Thank you so much for coming on the show and sharing and imparting that wisdom. I think it's amazing. I think more people need to listen to that stuff. And I think what you're doing and how you frame it is so critical. So thank you for sharing a little piece of yourself on
Very
the TED
well.
Show today.
Thank you so much.
All right. Informationcoaching.com. Ralph Andracchio. I tagged him on the post. I did, right? Twice in a row. It'll never happen again.
But thank
you for being open and vulnerable with us. We really do appreciate it.
Thank you.
All right, guys. We'll see you later this week. Have a great one.